Wow, what a number of people showing up. That's really wonderful. It's really an honor to be here, and I would like to thank the CCC in advance, in the beginning, for having us here. And we are, of course, Bits of Freedom. I would like to start out with a well-known quote. The quote goes, "Governments of the industrial world, you wary giants of flesh and steel. I come from cyberspace, the new home of mind." On behalf of the future, I ask you of the past to leave us alone. You are not welcome amongst us. You have no sovereignty where we gather. It's a quote from the Declaration of Independence of Cyberspace. It was written by Barlow in 1996, and you probably know Barlow. He was one of the founders of the EFF. Unfortunately, and this was to be expected, those wary giants of flesh and steel, they did not really listen, and the consequences are massive. Now, we always thought that the technology was one step ahead. Take, for example, file sharing, where you first had Napster. Napster made file sharing really, really big, but it did have a single point of failure. There was one company with one single database, and this database told you, you can find this file on this computer, and you can find this file on this computer. So after a couple of legal cases, Napster was brought down. Then there were alternatives like Casa, but even those had some flaws and were taken down in the end. And now you have BitTorrent, which is still there, which is not a single network anymore, and which is a lot harder to take down. So technology was really improving all the time, but policymakers are catching up. And this is really a big problem for our digital freedom, because those policymakers come up with all kinds of measures which have an impact on our digital freedoms. Take, for example, internet filters. There are several countries in Europe that already have an internet filter in place, and where the government tells you which information you can see and which information is not accessible for you. In countries outside of Europe, governments have taken this even a step further. Some countries don't really have an internet anymore, and it's more like an intranet. And policymakers also think of the current times as being the dark ages. They think that law enforcement agencies are no longer able to catch criminals. But the opposite is true. You know this, I know this, because we cannot do anything anymore today without leaving traces. We've never left so many traces in our daily, in whatever we do in our daily lives. So all these measures from the government, all these laws, all these policies, they have a huge impact on our digital freedoms. So the battleground is shifting. It's not only technology anymore, but it's also policy. And that's why the political activism also needs to change. There needs to be a lot more political activism. And thankfully, this has been changing in the past few years. We all know the big protests of ACTA, with hundreds of thousands of people out on the streets protesting against this treaty and trying to defend their digital freedoms. But we need a lot more of such a political movements. We need a lot more political activism. So what we want to do today here is try to name a few of the elements which make political activism a success. This is not our own experience. It's the experience of organizations like EDRI, like EFF, like Quadrature du Net, Panopticon, and many more. But it's also the experience of Bits of Freedom.
So let me first second what Reo said. I think that it's an honor to be here. And it's not only an honor because it's such a good atmosphere, but it's an honor because of you, because of the people which, in my opinion, will shape the future of technology, and with the future of technology will shape the future of the information society we live in. And that's why I think it's so important that we talk about this topic today. So we are Bits of Freedom, and Bits of Freedom is a Dutch digital rights organization. Reo already named some others which are active on this field, such as European Digital Rights Initiative, Panopticon, and in Germany, Digital Courage, and others like Digitale Gesellschaft. And in the past 3 years, we have had some experience in changing policy. And here's the good news, that in fact it can be changed. That although the battlefield is shifting, and although we are seeing that policymakers are trying to restrict our digital freedoms, we can in fact fight back. And one important example of this was ACTA, which was an epic victory. I remember clearly people talking about this last year, saying that it would be an uphill battle, but we won. And this was amazing. It turned out that the European Parliament, in fact, listened to us. And this is something we have to keep in mind. And another epic victory in the Netherlands, which we will refer to a lot, is debt neutrality. The Netherlands is the first country in Europe and the second country in the world which actually has net neutrality enshrined in law, and we will talk a bit about how this works. So let me first tell you a bit about Bits of Freedom, and then we'll get to the points. So Bits of Freedom is six people, basically, six FTE, six full-time employees, and approximately 300 volunteers who, one way or another, help us with our work. We act on a Dutch level, so national level, and on a European level, together with other organizations. And what we do is we, on the one hand, try to influence policy by advising politicians, and on the other hand, trying to influence policy by informing people and campaigning and giving them tools to defend themselves. And what we're going to talk about today is the campaigning policy part. Rayo will start off with the first of the 5 points which we think are important if you want to kickstart your own movement for whatever reason you feel or are passionate about.
But before I start with these 6 points, I think we've identified.
Sorry.
Before I start with those 6 points, I would like to say first that there is no a magic silver bullet. It has no one way to do this. The experiences we are talking about today, these are our experiences and the experiences of organizations like ours. But there are probably many other ways to do this. So this is not the way to do it. And also, I think that most of the key elements we will be naming, they will sound very obvious to you. And this is true, because they are logical. But the thing is, we tend to forget those when we're in the heat of the fight. But let me start with the first one, and that would be, you need to have a clear goal. Without a clear goal, you will have, well, there's not such a big chance on success. Let me illustrate this point by giving you two examples. The first example would be of Gina Crossley. She's a mother, and she writes a lot on her blog, which is named feministbreeder.com. And she posts a lot of images. She posts a lot of photos of her breastfeeding her kids, and she posts those to her website, but also to Facebook. On one of those photos, you can see her breastfeeding her one-year-old. And the one-year-old has a piece of bacon in her hand. This photo is being banned on Facebook. I don't know why, and if you know, please tell me afterwards, because I'm really curious, but I don't really understand. So Facebook took down the photo and disabled her account. She could no longer log in. After a few protests, the account was enabled again, and the photo was only put back online after 3 weeks. Meanwhile, another photo of her breastfeeding a kid was taken down. And of course, Facebook does have a legitimate interest. And of course, Facebook has they should be able to tell what is going on the network, on their own network, of course. But on the other hand, Facebook is becoming this important that it's becoming a platform for public debate. And if you start taking away images then, this will have, obviously, an impact on the freedom of speech. So it's a delicate balance, and Facebook needs to have a good policy on this. But Facebook does not have a good policy on this at this moment, and they're definitely not transparent about it. We are worried about this, but we have not been able to change it. And I think that one of the reasons why we were not able to change it is that we didn't really have a goal. We didn't really think of the what we were aiming for, and we didn't list our demands. And partly because of that, Facebook still has this shitty policy. But let me give you another example of how this can be different. This year, we had elections in the Netherlands again. And these are wonderful moments because so many things are happening and politicians are speaking out suddenly. And there we thought it's good to put our demands, to list our demands. So we made an Internet Freedom Manifesto. It listed 11 articles which said we want politicians to think about reform copyright. And we want to make sure that the politicians are thinking about how to enforce net neutrality effectively. Then we were waiting a few days for... let me tell you one thing else. Internet Freedom Manifesto, it doesn't really help if it's just on our desk and that's it. So we ask our constituency to send this Internet Freedom Manifesto to the political parties. And I'm pretty sure they've seen it, all of them, because one of those political parties sent me an email asking me to stop it. Stop the campaigning, because they had seen it so many times. So that did work. Then they were publishing their draft election programs, and in those draft election programs they tell you what they are planning to do in the next 4 years. And we carefully made a review of these election programs, and then it turned out a lot could be changed and could be made better in order to protect digital freedoms. So then we made a list of amendments, we made a list of changes that should have been made. Then we asked political members of those parties to discuss these amendments and to have those changes incorporated in the final election programs. And when in the end the final election programs were published, we were really happy to see that quite a few of our proposed changes were incorporated in those programs. And this is really important, because this way we could put digital freedom on the political agenda during the elections, but not only during the elections, because the politicians take a position, and this will mean that that digital freedoms will be on the agenda for the next 4 years. And I think we have been very, very successful in this, because we had a goal. We set a goal before we started. We wanted to make sure that politicians would be talking about digital freedoms, and we thought about, okay, how are we going to do this? And to do this, it's not really difficult, because all of you already have a good idea on what digital freedoms, on how they should look like, on how they should be protected, and what the government should do and what the government definitely should not do. So write it down and make for yourself clear, we are right here now, we want to go there, and this is the path we're going to take. And if you have this in your mind, then you will do so very effectively. And there's one thing which I already mentioned here, is you need to be prepared.
Yeah, so you have this goal, like you want to, destroy the medical health database, which has all your private data in it, and ensure that policymakers will not ever think of reinstalling it again. And you have this goal, and the next step then is what? So we think that the next step is to be prepared. And let me take you back to 1.5 years ago in London. On 10 May 2011, during a shareholders meeting of KPN, the Dutch telco incumbent, one of the directors of mobile retail of KPN then bragged about to his shareholders about the fact that he was using DPI to analyze the traffic of his users. And with this traffic, he could see how many people were using WhatsApp. And on the basis of this information, he made the case for net neutrality infringing policies, like blocking WhatsApp and instead charging for SMS. After he told this, it was silent for 2 days. Investigative reporters didn't notice it. Until 2 days later, one investigative reporter looked on a video, saw what the director actually did, and manage to write a blog about it. We then immediately jumped on it, seized the opportunity, and told our constituency that they had to file a complaint with KPN and that they were actually infringing criminal law. This went from nothing to something to a media storm in about half a day. And in the end, it was in the 8 o'clock news, in the evening 8 o'clock news, where we gave a quote and we managed to gain momentum. And this momentum we could use later on to form a majority with the parliament to actually push for legislation which could basically restrict the use of DPI. And the thing I take out of this is basically twofold. First of all, the dynamic of the media is very unpredictable. And things can become a hype within half a day, or even sometimes 2 to 3 hours. And if you operate in this environment, you need to be prepared for this. And that's the second thing is, we're basically not working on an instinct doing ad hoc stuff. This was something we were working on for 2 years already. We had contacts with our policymakers. We were advising them on draft legislation which could curtail this. And we only had to wait for the right moment to get our point across. So that's basically the point which we wanted to make also, is that be prepared means taking a long-term view and thinking for yourself, like, we're here now, we want to go there. This will take approximately 2 to 3 years. That's basically the time frame you have to talk about. And then within these 2 to 3 years, make a plan for yourself. And this plan will involve different steps. Firstly, framing, and we'll get to that later. Drafting your, creating your position, so like really trying to clearly articulate what you are actually aiming for. Drafting legislation, if that's what you want, or drafting policy. And then talking to policymakers and stakeholders, and we'll get to that later on. So that basically brings us to the next point.
Yeah, but you already briefly mentioned it, actually. Because, like Otto already told, on May the 12th, there was only one news outlet saying something about KPN's DPI. And we were the first ones to jump in. And this is really important, because we were the first ones to explain what KPN actually was doing. We were the first ones to explain what DPI means, what deep packet inspection entails. And we were the first ones to explain the concept of net neutrality. We were the first ones to explain, okay, an internet user should have the freedom to choose to do whatever he likes on the internet. It's not that a company should tell you you are not allowed to use WhatsApp, or you're not allowed to use YouTube or any other service. You should be the one who can choose. And this worked because we were the first ones, and because we are the first ones, we were able to put that concept into the minds of people. And if a policymaker would hear other arguments, would hear counter arguments, this policymaker would always compare this to our arguments, and that's where you have a good advantage. So be early is very, very important, and if you're being prepared, then you can seize the moment when there is one. Another thing which already was mentioned once is you need to frame your message very well. Picking the right frame is very, very important. And I want to illustrate this with another example. In the Netherlands, it's the same just like everywhere, sexual abuse of children is something of a hot debate. And politicians, sometimes they are more concerned about their own image than about the actual problem or solving the actual problem. So this is the same in this topic as well. And the policymakers had a proposal for an internet filter in the Netherlands. And I don't have to explain to you that a DNS filter doesn't really help. You can go around that one very, very easily.
We were first trying to attack this problem by telling the government that internet filters they are bad and they will have a negative effect on digital freedoms in the long run, but that didn't really work. That changed once we started to use a different frame. At one point in time, we said, "Okay, you should act. You should not look away." And this is a frame we were borrowing from MOGIS, which is a German organization. Thanks for that. And by using this frame, we were able to change the debate completely. We were able to tell, "Okay, the real problem is the distribution and the production of images of sexual abuse of children. And if you want to solve this, if you want to solve this problem, you should not hide those images, but you should prosecute the perpetrators and you should identify the victims." And once we were telling this story, the debate was fairly quickly done. We were winning. The proposal for an internet filter is off the table, and since then it hasn't been back. So it's really, really important to pick the right frame. It's really important to think about how you bring your message. And picking the right frame is very, very difficult. We are struggling with it, maybe not on a daily basis, but very frequently. If you want to pick the right frame, the best starting point is the problem of your opponent. And it's not you should not think about their frame, but think about their problem. So in case with the internet filter, you should ask yourself, what is the problem they're trying to solve? And then you think about the images of sexual abuse of children, and then you immediately know an internet filter will only hide it. It will not solve the problem. Once you have thought of a frame, then you need to test it. You need to talk to people around you. You need to talk to your parents, to your friends, to everyone around you, and test it. You need to see if the frame, if it will stick, if it will resonate, if people will remember it, if there are a lot of counter arguments, and if there are none, if the frame is taken by your friends and they are using it for their friends. A good frame will propagate like a virus. It you will put it out there once and then it will slowly get around. And it's also important to not think of the frame doesn't really need to touch the fundamental issues. You should use something which people can identify with. That's a lot more important. So a frame is really, really important. Maybe it's even the most important thing we are doing, because if you pick the right frame, the rest will go by itself. So, and then there are two more points to mention.
Yeah, so let me get to the last two points, which probably are also self-obvious, but we need to emphasize them at any rate. So first one is be understanding. If you want to get your point across, you'll have to know what the legitimate interests of the other party actually are. And I thought that this was actually the most interesting aspect of the process of drafting legislation for net neutrality, because we were forced to think about whether there would be certain legitimate exceptions to the rule that traffic should not be hindered, slowed down, throttled, etc. And I clearly remember a talk about net neutrality 2 to 3 years ago at this Congress, where people were quite critical about the question whether all traffic should be treated equally, and quite rightly so, because not all traffic should be treated equally. So we had to think about whether there were certain legitimate exceptions. And why is it important to think about this? Because if you talk to a policymaker, this will be the first question they will ask, like, okay, well, you know, net neutrality is all very nice, but what about network security? What about congestion? What about spam or whatever? And how do you deal with these issues? And if you have an answer ready and are able to, in fact, come up with constructive proposals to address those concerns, your story will be much more likely to be adopted by the other party. And the way we did this, and I think that this is very generally applicable, is first of all, talk to your opponent. Opponents are always very happy to talk to you and talk about all the problems they have, and you have to be very critical. You know, Google comes by, drops by at our office, and they tell all these problems, and sometimes we do not really know whether they're genuine problems or not, so we have to ask really critical questions. And this is where the other part comes in. You need to get help from experts. And probably most of you are the experts in this field, so you'll be able to counter any fake arguments they will have at their disposal. But that's the second one. And the third one is you have to think of these arguments yourself. Like, brainstorm with your friends and try to think what your opponent would come up with and try to address these concerns. So those are the three things. And then the last one, and this is basically something which I think is more about sustainability, and this is be focused, remain focused. So you have your goal, you're prepared, you're working on whatever policy and talking to stakeholders and policymakers and whatever, and you will find that the media will want something from you. And they may want, you know, a quote on something which is not really related to your field, and it's sort of attractive because being on the television is nice, and, you know, giving an interview on the radio is nice. But you have to remember, first of all, that it will dilute your reputation. Basically, the common public will not know what you're actually aiming for. And second of all the time you invest in doing that is not invested in achieving your goal. And the thing is, you'll get up in the morning and your Twitter stream is filling itself up in about 10 seconds and your email box is constantly overflowing. And if you want to remain alive, and then, you know, and you want to keep your operation sustainable, focus, focus, focus. Don't be distracted. Even though you're passionate about these issues, this doesn't mean that you have to do everything at once. In fact, you shouldn't, because it will make your life a lot more difficult, and you'll burn out in the end. And this is something which activists, a very serious risk for activists, I think. So, last one, remain focused.
It doesn't really help that if you've won the war, but then you don't have a life anymore. So, that's why it's important. Let me make some closing comments. I think the next few years will be very, very interesting years, because I'm pretty sure the policymakers will step up their effort, and I'm pretty sure there will be even more civilians coming up. And it's already there's already a lot going on. Our medical records are in a centralized database. You cannot travel from A to B without being registered, and there's so much going on already. And on many of those fields, nobody is seriously working on it. And this is really a big problem. And we would like you to we would like to ask you to. Well, for the issues that are important to you, for the issues you are passionate about, to start a movement, and we will be helping you with it if it's needed. We want to give you advice in how you should do that. But for the issues you are passionate about, start a movement. And if you're not able to start a movement, please be sure to contribute to one. There are many organizations, I already mentioned a few, like Panopticon, like EDRI, EFF, Digitale Gesellschaft, and of course Bits of Freedom. So please start a movement or help the others. Thanks.
Thank you very much for the insightful talk. The speakers will now take the questions, if any. Yeah, please. Okay, you will be next.
Thank you very much. It's more a statement than a question, because I'm exactly one of those politicians you speak of, and I please you stay a few minutes after this and let us exchange contacts, because I'm here to get all those information and all those contacts to bring your ideas into the political process. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have one question. If you have an opponent, perhaps he lives in another world. He lives in a golden cave where he has no problems because he's using some kind of operating system or which has no problem for him because it's all problems are solved in his mind. So how do you get your opponent out of his golden cave and come into your world to talk about the problems you think that are important?
Okay, so one thing I found very insightful was that at one time at the European Parliament, a plan was floated to install boxes with DPI in every house and, you know, check whether people were doing things which were illegal or whatever. And it was basically just a plan, nothing serious, so you didn't really hear about it. But one seasoned political activist then said, you know, why don't they test this box with all the European Parliament members and try to see if they are doing something fraudulent, because it's very important that they spend our tax money correctly, right? So you have to change the plan and apply it to them. And sometimes this works.
That's one thing, and the other thing I want to add here is also you need to be prepared again. Like data breaches, it wasn't really on the political agenda in the Netherlands for quite some time. But then Bits of Freedom started to make an inventory of all the data leaks which were happening. And after 1.5 years, we had this gigantic list of issues, of leaks. And with such a list, then only we could make politicians think about the real problem. So sometimes you need to take your time to prove what the problem that there is a problem.
Other questions?
Yeah. Hello. You speak as though there's only two agencies involved in this, which is the politicians and the activists lobbying against them. But it seems to me the final problem you're going to have is the people. If a politician, say, is malicious in some sense, they can spread scare stories, and it's who the people vote for at the end of the day that's really going to decide the future shape of the law. Yet we seem to have a problem that the majority of the people don't have any understanding still of net issues, nor interest in it. If they see something that's shiny, they'll sign up to it. They don't care if there's any issues with it. Do you perceive there's anything that can be done with that, or is it a lost cause that people just don't care about? And do you perceive that that's a gender issue? Not gender, sorry, an age issue? Is it that older people, younger people coming up are more aware of the issues surrounding the net, or are they still as they've always been?
Okay. So you're asking basically two questions, I think. First of all is whether the public is becoming more aware, and the second is whether politicians are actually listening to these issues. And I think those are very, very, very much intertwined. And as I said, I think that we are seeing a shift of the public becoming involved in this. And obviously, the people who are, you know, massive smartphone users and whatever will be the first to adopt our positions. But these will very quickly be adopted by others. I was very surprised that my mother-in-law actually forwarded me an email about a petition by Access about ECDA. And I was like, I didn't know about this petition. And she, for one reason or another, got wind of it. So basically, I think that the public is very much aware of it, and I think if the public is becoming aware of it, politicians cannot ignore it, and that's what we're seeing right now with ACTA, and hopefully with a lot of other things as well.
Yes, and we try to explain our issue to the public as well, of course, not only to the politicians. Any more questions?
Hello. I was wondering about how do you try and combat any false information that gets out there? How do you also when they say we're talking about we're arguing for the pro side, if there's other lobbyists on the other side then who also have experts who may be more false in their statements, how do you combat that? How do you go up against it and make sure that what your information, if it's the correct information, is the information that everyone's realizing is correct?
Well, one important thing is that we put a lot of effort in making sure that our message is correct. So when we are saying something, people know it is the truth. People know it's true. And I think that's very important because then people will not doubt your message. So what we do actually is really we put a lot of time in talking to experts, making sure we understand technology, we understand the legal aspects of something, really understand the problem, and then we say something which we are 100% sure it's true. And I think that's really important. Maybe.
Yeah, and trying to debunk the false information, obviously. But I think it's a very good question, and I think it's something that we will see a lot more in the coming years, because it's so much easier to spread disinformation on the internet right now. You can start, you know, with an anonymous comment somewhere, and from there build a blogging ecosystem which basically creates falsehood and turns it into truth. And this is something which we need to find a counter strategy against. And I don't really have it because you want to be honest, basically. And if you're fighting on their terms, then you'll probably lose. So I think it's a very serious question, and I don't have a real answer to it.
Hello. Just quickly on that, I ran a campaign against electronic voting machines, and within a couple of months you can become known as the party that is generally truthful and right about things, and the other party very quickly becomes known as the party that's continuously manipulating and twisting the truth. About something else you said, or Rio said, there's this dichotomy between planning where you are and where you want to go, as you said it, you are at A, you want to be at B, and being prepared and sort of going with the flow if things start happening, which I think there's going to be much more of the latter than of the former, and I think a lot of activism is over focusing on the present, is over focusing on what is already sort of a result of a chaotic shifting of states. As thinking of it as a set state that we need to move away from. It's much more, news is much more chaotic, the 24-hour news cycle is very chaotic, and the present state is much less fixed than people think. I think if you dare to dream, if you dare to step out of the present, and if you just set down what you would like to see as a law or as a policy or I think there needs to be a lot more of that, a lot more dreaming, even if it's 5 years into the future, because the present situation is so the word is overused, but so unsustainable that large changes are going to happen anyway, and you might as well think 2 years into the future instead of trying to move this status quo that's not going to hold anyway.
I think that 2 years is even very sort of pessimistic. If you want to have something which is really sustainable, then you'll have to think 3 to 5 years ahead, and you shouldn't get involved too much in the media cycle, which is really frantically going rapidly berserk currently. Although you cannot live without it, that's the problem. I mean, if you want to create momentum and gain awareness about your issues, you will undoubtedly have to sometimes step into the media hype and also, you know, perform your role. But you'll have to be very clear to what you're aiming for and keep the long term in mind.
And I think that it's not only like in 5 years, but maybe it's also thinking about what we want to have in 25 years. So more being a visionary instead of just trying to influence the law and take into account that it's taking 5 years. So think not only about, think about the 5-year plan, but also think about the 25-year plan.
Have you ever had encountered problems with opponents who just don't want to move and will just can't be persuaded and etc.?
Could you repeat the question? Yes.
Have you ever encountered problems with opponents to your position which simply cannot be persuaded because there isn't a way which is acceptable to both you and them?
Right. Okay, so the question is, do you sometimes have opponents which actually cannot be persuaded because, you know, they are not open to your viewpoints at any rate? Yeah, definitely. And the thing is, if you have the spectrum, there's the political spectrum. On the one hand, you have the people who are very much in line with you. On the other hand, there's people who you will never convince anyway. And there's this middle part between, and this is the part you're aiming at. And you're trying to create a majority by shifting those towards your spectrum. And the others you can safely ignore because they will not be convinced. And if you feel that you're picking a battle in which you will not gain this majority, then maybe you shouldn't do it and invest your energy in other issues. There are some questions.
In the back.
Okay, sorry.
It strikes me that you focus so much on telling the real story and finding out the real truths and double-checking that it's really right. I have an academic background, as you may know, and I talk to politicians and activists, and they say, no, in politics, it's all about perceptions. So you have to focus on the story that works best and not necessarily on the truth. Well, you already told your position, but what's the answer if they say focus on perception and tell the story that works best?
Okay. I think if you are doing this for the long term, then you need to focus on the truth, because otherwise you will be identified as a manipulator and someone who is not to be trusted, as Rob rightly pointed out. But there are different ways of telling the truth, and I think this is where our point of framing is really important, because you can either say, you know, DNS blocking is not effective because it can be very easily circumvented, or you can say DNS blocking is not effective to address the abuse of sexual abuse of children because you know, the perpetrators are not being jailed. And the challenge is to look for a story which is true but also resonates.
Hello. One guy asked about how you cope with irrelevant informations, but I wanted to know, how do you deal with just irrelevant problematics or, you know, bogus problems? Most often, policymakers just expose one part of the problems we may encounter and just offer the right tool to solve it, but the real goal is to set the tool. It's not the problem, and you said at the point that it's a good way to gain some weight, to give better answers to problems that are exposed. But most often, the real problem is what's exposed. It's not relevant. Just like, I'm very happy you had a victory with child abuse, but most of the time when we do hear about child abuse, it's to hear about internet filtering or something. It's not really about the kids, it's about control. Mm. There are so many other fields to, you know, to help children in sports clubs or anything. It's, how do you reveal that trick?
I think it's a good question, by the way. I think what we do also a lot is trying to find the truth. So we're trying to determine what is actually behind a proposal. And by doing so,
this will help you pick the right frame, for example. So it's important on many levels. It's not only important for telling the story, but it's also important to know what is really going on. And we are doing quite a few, some research in looking in, okay, this is the proposal, but what went on before there was this proposal? So what is going on actually?
It's easy to get in a debate, but it's quite difficult to shift a debate. And I think that most of the time that's the way to go.
No, that is difficult, of course, and but that I think we already mentioned a few times now is that it all boils down to one thing: picking the right frame. So you have this problem, you need to find out what's it all about, and then you need to rethink about it and start thinking about, okay, this is the problem, but how are we going to bring this? How are we going to explain this issue?
Yeah,
a different one.
Maybe I can add to this. In communication theory, I understand that there's a way of using the frame of your opponent to your own advantage. So if your opponent says, for example, in privacy, corporations often say something like, you know, for us, all these rules make it very complicated to do our business. Then you try to identify the underlying value of this frame, and the underlying value of this frame is basically, for us, legality and knowing what we're up to is very important. That's the frame. Then you take the counter frame of that frame, the counter value of that frame, and you say, well, you know, for consumers, trust is also very important. This is so you need to be able to know what you're up to, but consumers need to be able to know what they're up to as well. You know, you use their frame, pick the underlying value, use it to your own advantage, and then reframe it and use their argument to your advantage. It's a very theoretical, but you know, take 15 minutes to do this exercise, and it will allow you to do some like communication jiu-jitsu or whatever. Yeah. Thanks.
We have a question from the internets. So some people are having difficulty understanding how an individual could benefit directly from being an activist. Essentially, what might motivate someone not specifically interested in the common good?
The nice thing about our work is that we are working on problems which have an effect on myself right away. So if you look at net neutrality, for example, winning this battle makes it that I have different that the companies are sending me a different kind of phone. They are no longer telling me, okay, if you want to go to YouTube, you need to pay some extra money for this. So for many of the topics we are working on, there is a direct relationship between what I'm trying to fix and my own environment. So for some of the topics, of course, this line is a bit thinner, I think. But for many of the topics, there's a direct relationship, and that makes it very easy somewhere and very cool to do this.
Thought it might be easier to just come to the mic. My question involves the 5 and 25 year plan that you guys were talking about earlier, simply because it seems like a lot of our recent victories, especially like things like ACTA, were actually more like 5-month plans, and they all came together in one big flash. So what do you guys do to manage something that rises and falls as quickly as internet culture does?
So, in addition to what we spoke earlier about, the fact that internet can be easily used to turn falsehoods into truths, there's another dynamic which we are currently discovering, which makes activism much more difficult, and this is the fact that that unwanted policy or trying to change policy It's becoming so much more like a flash in the pan kind of a dynamic. You know, you have these swarms going on to something, picking it and picking the carcass empty and then going away. And this is one way to do activism, but it's the question whether it's sustainable in the long run. So I think this is something where we as organizations, sort of the leaders of the movement for internet freedom, need to be very aware of whether we're not depleting a resource and depleting the trust of politicians in, say, in civil society and internet nerd citizenship, whatever. So it's something we are very much thinking about, how to do the next ACTA without using up the trust we are gradually building with politicians. Yeah, very legitimate question.
Question. Just a short one. How do you finance your activities?
Very good question. So we're financed via three types of income. First of all, individual donations. Those are somewhat less than one-third of our budget. Foundations, those are a bit more than one-third of our budget. And corporations, and those are like one-fifth or one-sixth of our budget. And those are mostly freelancers giving 500 euros and stuff like that. So we have a budget of 400,000 euros approximately. And yeah, that's about it.
And it's probably important to stress that we are using this setup because we want to be independent. So there's not one single big company giving us our budget, so we will be very dependent. We're not getting any money from the government because that would give us some dependence. We have this three way structure because that makes us independent.
But then I would like to set up something like this in Germany, so I need money. How could I convince and whom? There is already a good example in the neighbor country. Who is giving the, who are those donators?
Okay, so there are certain foundations which are definitely interested in becoming more active in this field. You can come to me later if you want to have more information on this. And the other one, which I think is very important, is individual donations really should be a large part of your income, because basically those are the people you are defending. Whenever there's something like an ad hoc movement, I don't know, you're doing something against ECTA, already start building for the larger, more sustainable NGO kind of thing. Yeah.
I have a question. You made it all sound so easy. You just sent emails to the parties, you made amendments to their party programs, and then they listened to you. But I can't imagine that it is that easy. I mean, how do you counter the lobbyism of telcos that don't want net neutrality, because it's a new field of profit they can make, and I don't think they will let this slip out of their hands that easy. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with that?
I think it's not easy. I think it's doable. That's something which I hope you can take away. And it requires long-term planning, like 2 to 3 years investing your time in it. But then if you do that, it's doable. And that's something where I think we have the advantage. Time and society is on our hand. People think internet freedom is so very important to them that if you manage to sort of latch on to that and sort of help build the momentum for internet freedom, it will sort of take care of itself also. So you just need to be the leader of the movement and dare to dream, and then it's doable.
We will take the last question.
Okay, also my question is, how important are insiders or whistleblowers to get information from? Because do you have some kind of bullshit law monitoring or stuff like that? You talked about preparing is so important because preparing needs time. And if policymakers are creating contracts or laws in secret, and you can't prepare what you don't know about.
I think I'm not sure whether we've seen much information from whistleblowers, which helped us a lot. I don't think there's much, but we spent quite some time in doing, for example, Freedom of Information Act requests. And of course, the government is already telling, does already do press releases from time to time and tells the story in their with their frame. But to know what is going on, actually, you need to do some research. You need to look into the problem that is there, that is trying to be solved. You need to investigate what actually the government is up to and what they are planning and what they are wanting to do. And this also takes a long-term planning, because doing Freedom of Information Act requests before you get the answer, it takes a long, long time. But without those, you can never find out what the government is really up to. So that's one way we get the information on what actually is going on.
Okay.
Okay. So. This is the end of the presentation. Let's thank the speakers.